The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan, 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com. Everybody knows we've got a mountain of debt that can never be paid off. If you listen to this show at all, you know I've been talking about a debt jubilee, at least a partial debt jubilee, for quite some time. Well, I've got Jason Hamlin on here right now with me. And finally, I found somebody who agrees with me somewhat. Jason's proprietor of GoldStockBull.com. Jason, how are you?
Doing pretty well. Just trying to survive the heat out here. It's been a brutal summer.
Yeah, ours in the East Coast here has not been that bad. We've had some hot days, some high 90s, but mostly it's been mid-80s. And I guess the climate change came to your side of the continent this year. So,
but yeah, we've been well above 100 degrees for several days each week throughout the summer. And it's been a little bit difficult to get used to because we're not typically quite this hot during the summers here.
Yeah, well, California is a big desert, as we all know. So we're talking about the fact that debt, originally it starts out increasing arithmetically, but now we're at the point where it's increasing geometrically. And at best, you can only hope that your incomes and revenues to the government will increase arithmetically at a 3% annual rate. And yet when debt's going up 25-30% annually, it's never going to get paid off, is it?
No, I write about this pretty extensively. I think it's central to the problems that we're facing, the economic problems, the debt problems, the Eurozone problems, and the conclusion that I've come to is that the debt cannot be paid off. It's a mathematic impossibility. And you don't hear a lot of people talking about this, but the fact is that all money is created out of debt, and interest is attached to all of that money that's created. And the problem is that that interest does not exist. It's not in the system, so it's not there to be able to be paid back.
It has to be printed up, right? It's got to be created out of thin air, right?
Right, and even that additional money, though, is also created with interest attached. So mathematically, the debt can never be paid off. All it does is allows concentration of wealth and concentration of resources to those that are printing the money. And as time goes on, the amount of interest that's owed as a percent of the total outstanding cash, total outstanding money in existence, grows larger and larger and larger until it's quite impossible to even think about paying back your principal, let alone your interest. And that's the situation a lot of sovereign nations are finding themselves in right now.
And households and cities, counties around the globe. This isn't a localized phenomena by any stretch. And my grandfather, who had an eighth grade education but was quite successful in business, used to say, when you're paying interest on interest, you've got a real problem. And that's what the world's doing. They can't even service the debt. All they're doing is paying interest on interest. So what's the solution here, Jason?
Oh, you're absolutely right about it stretching through all levels. And here in California, we've had three or four different cities declare bankruptcy just this year. So it's reaching its tentacles throughout society. The solution that I've come up with is that we basically need a modern day debt jubilee. We need to go ahead and default, sort of hit the reset button and start over. And as drastic, crazy as a solution that may sound, that really is the only way forward. The solutions being proposed thus far are either to, austerity, which isn't going to solve the problem, or tax increases, which of course just slows growth also. So both of those are non-starters as far as I'm concerned. We have to actually wipe the debt out and start over with some kind of system that is a debt-free monetary system.
Yeah, no consumer debt allowed. If you want to buy a flat screen, You pay for it out of your pocket. You know, go back to what American Express used to be, which was they'd advance you the money for a month and you'd pay it when you got the bill. You had like 10 or 15 days. They weren't in the business of printing money. Now Amex is a bank and a commercial bank. Their monopoly, their franchise is to print money. And, you know, we're seeing this all over the place. One thing that Bix Weir pointed out, and whether you agree with his philosophy or not, it's unimportant, but one man's debt jubilee is another bank's asset jubilee, which means if my mortgage gets forgiven, then the XYZ bank down on the street corner has got a real problem, which means that you will literally have to close down the banking sector and come up with a solution to it. So my feeling is for individuals, you might need to do a complete jubilee. For businesses, it might be partial, because if a company's sitting with $50 billion in cash and they just sold, you know, $12 billion in corporate bonds, they shouldn't get the benefit of the jubilee. So a jubilee, really, that's the beginning, because you need banking system reform or new system put in place, and you need drastic monetary reform, because the money system will cease to exist.
Yeah, I have no problem seeing the destruction of the banking system as we know it right now. That wouldn't bother me a single bit. I mean, they've grown to be such a parasitical force in society. They're really providing very little value. All they're doing is getting the privilege of the governments to be able to print the money, get it at near zero interest rate, and then be able to loan it out to the citizens at higher rates. And of course, if you miss a single payment, all of a sudden your rate gets jacked up double digits and you're in some kind of debt spiral that you can't get out of. So how they're even allowed to exist and operate on the level that they do today is really amazing. And I think people are just slumbering through the fact that we're really getting exploited by the banking system.
Yeah, like they have this thing called RICO, Racketeer Influenced Corrupt Organization Act. And that was so they could throw mafia dons into jail. Well, certainly the banking industry as it exists now is one big corrupt organization. And if you're lucky enough to be a member of it, then all your needs, your wealth, it's all taken care of for you. But if you're not, then you're a debt slave. And at least with the banksters, with their debt, you can always go bankrupt and get it discharged. But, you know, and I don't want to get into the student loans, only to mention that with student loans, that is a unique category of debt, can never be discharged in bankruptcy. It's with you for life, you know, just like death and taxes, student loans, that's with you. So certainly the jubilee should start with student debt.
Well, I think there's some moral and even legal justification for such a thing, and that is that, you know, most legal contracts require some sort of consideration. And from my viewpoint, the banks aren't really offering up any consideration, because they're just typing this loan as a keyboard entry or printing the money out of thin air. So what are they risking or giving out front? And it's really nothing. So if you default on a student loan or on a mortgage, I think you have some moral and legal ground from my perspective. But there's a giant sucking sound that we're hearing in society, and that's really the banks sucking out the wealth from the citizenry, from the middle class in particular, up into we're getting this concentration that's getting more and more concentrated to where 1% now owns 40 or 50% of the wealth in the country. So anytime this kind of concentration happens, it's bad for society overall, and particularly when the people that are getting wealthy are ones that aren't adding value to society. They're not creating, they're not innovating. If anything, they're sucking the intellectual capital out of society. You know, engineers are, you know, going from PhDs into the banking sector rather than going out into society, designing more efficient systems, coming up with new inventions that enhance all of our lives. And, you know, so this is a huge problem. And the biggest part of it that's stopping us from any kind of resolution is that the banks have completely co-opted the government. So they are one. They're in bed together. The banks own the government. The government relies upon the banks. And so even when they're caught, you know, red-handed for fraud, it could be it's a situation where the fraud netted them, say, $2 billion, and then the fine is $500 million. So yeah. It's a great ROI if you're a bank. Commit the fraud, make $2 billion, and then pay a fine of $500 million. And this creates extreme moral hazard and just leads to more and more of the same activity. So if we don't change things, if there are not significant consequences for this kind of behavior, then it's just going to continue to get worse and worse. And I fear that that's where we are right now, a situation that's even worse than 2008 prior to the Lehman moment.
Absolutely. I mean, it's the Dukes of Moral Hazard. You know, they're in that Dodge Charger and they're going down the highway with no regard to the speed limit and no regard to any other motorist rights on there, because they're the Dukes. And, you know, we're just going to see this continue on. It's worse than they're just taking all the wealth. They're destroying, and like you said, sucking the intellectual capital out, because you could go to school, become an engineer, and get $65,000 a year if you can find a job, or you go into finance, and like you say, a very low value-added proposition at best, and come up with new algorithms to front-end the market by 15 nanoseconds so that your trade gets executed ahead of everyone else's, and you get huge bonuses and, you know, beach house in the Hamptons, and your life is set. You know, Ross Perot once said, there's only two places where a kid out of college can make $250,000 a year. One is selling drugs, and the other is Wall Street. And I'd argue that the drug dealer might be making a more profound contribution to society than the Wall Streeter, because this financial sector is bloated. It's misallocation of resources, right? One of the things we talk about as Austrians is malinvestment. And when money just gets printed out of thin air, the primary malinvestment is in that financial sector. And that's what we've seen, this bubble just blowing out of all sense of proportion. And just like Matt Taibbi at Rolling Stone called it the vampire squid. And, right. You know, it's like most parasites will try not to kill the host, but the vampire squid kills the host, and the last minute before the host is about to die, jumps for another host and repeats the process.
Yeah, and just a note on the algorithmic trading that you mentioned, there was an executive in Australia that came out and basically said high frequency trading is accounting for at least 75% of the market turnover on the exchanges there. So it's primarily all computers trading against each other, you know, on all these different calculations using co-location. And exactly. If you're just a regular investor trying to make some money, trying to, you know, make a profit, trying to invest successfully, it's becoming more and more difficult to do that now. Oh, and especially sure. With what you're talking about with misallocation of capital, as an analyst, as an investor, as a businessman, it's become nearly impossible to get any true idea of what's overvalued, undervalued, what might be going up or down, because the entire market moves on the whims of a few words from our grand wizard, Bernanke there. So, you know, we have no markets anymore. It's complete manipulation. If he says one word, the markets, you know, billions of dollars get added one way. And if he says the other word, billions of dollars get lost this way. So what an investor to do in this kind of environment, it becomes very difficult.
Yeah, because going back to the Austrian argument, markets exist to provide pricing data to participants so that they can orderly structure their affairs, plan out their businesses, make investments, calculate returns. I mean, that's why they exist. But now the purpose of markets is to psychologically bolster confidence in a system that is just in a major fail. And I just want to let you know, I've got a book coming out called Wipe the Street Clean, A Guide to Real Wealth. And that's what we deal with is, hey, the money system, the paper money system, scam. Everything that they're doing on Wall Street, scam, and they just exist to extract wealth. It's reverse Robin Hood, take from the poor, give to the rich. And I don't want to sound like some, you know, Occupying Wall Street guy, because that's not my background and that's not what I believe in, because they just want more government occupying Wall Street. I want less government. I want markets to be free and function as they were intended. just like the gold and silver markets have not been functioning as of late, but it looks like they're getting back, that somehow the dynamics have shifted in the past 3.5-4 weeks, you know?
Yeah, and a few things I would recommend to try to avoid some of that market manipulation is either direct registration or taking physical possession of your share certificates if you're going to hold for the long term. That removes some of the ability of the manipulators and the short sellers to use your shares against you, and also provides you some protection from a default or any kind of fraud from your broker. And then, of course, investing in physical metals that are in your possession, that's no one else's liability. That can't be taken away from you other than via theft. So you have to be kind of crafty with how you keep them in your possession. But I'm definitely have been moving more and more of my assets out of the banking system, out of stock investments, and into real tangible assets that are in my possession that, you know, I have access to at any point.
Yeah, I heard somebody mentioning the concept of using Claymore mines scattered around their house, so anybody comes to take their metals, you know, it worked. It was effective in Vietnam. Could work in protecting your gold, but obviously not a good idea to keep it at home, near and dear, close to your heart. You got to put it someplace, but there are options to minimize counterparty risk. It's something that we all need to think about, but that's for another day. So, Jason, what's your site again?
It's goldstockbull.com, GoldStockBull.com. I've been putting this newsletter out for about 6 or 7 years. It's primarily looking at undervalued mining equities. My background was in analysis for a market research company for a long time, and basically turning data into insights in the corporate world, and that sucked the energy out of me after a while. And
I wonder why.
Put the skills to use in the newsletter. And so we've done quite well over the past several years, outperforming the market. This year has been a little rough, but I think the negative sentiment by gold investors is a little bit overdone, because gold is actually up 6% year to date. Silver's up 10.5% year to date. So if you talk to a gold or silver investor, you would think that it was down 20 or 30%, but the metals are actually doing quite well, especially in the past month. And what else also been very positive to see is that the mining stocks have actually outperformed gold and silver during this last run. Gold's up about 2.5% in the past month, and GDX is up about 8%. So I think that foreshadows what's coming in the future. I think the real value here, provided we don't have a complete collapse of the market, is in mining equities that are significantly oversold and undervalued in my estimate. So I would never put more than 30 or 40% of my total wealth into it, but it's good to have your eggs in several baskets. And if you are going to invest in the market, I think that mining shares is the place to be, and that there's some excellent opportunities right now.
Oh yeah, these companies are worth more dead than alive. There is a company that I owned several years ago, did really well on it, sold it off. La Mancha Resources, I think, was the name. Just got bought out by an Egyptian billionaire. He bought it for the equivalent of $50 the ounce in the ground. Wrote a check for $500 million, and you know what? That is a sign of things to come. Jason, thanks so much for being on FinancialSurvivalNetwork.com. You want to hear this interview with Jason, as well as others we've done, as well as interviews with financial authorities the world over, financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Jason, you be well. We'll talk to you soon.
All right. Thanks for having me, Kerry.